Thank you for sticking around. We're getting towards the end of the day where we will hear some special presentations from Stanford researchers who are doing, again, really innovative work in child and maternal health. They're shown here. The first will be from Theo Palmer, psychiatrist who's pioneering the use of neural stem cells to decode developing an adult brain. And then we'll hear from Dr. Sam Cheshire, whose name got kind of mangled on the slide somehow. He's Sam Stanford. Bears no relation. he's a pediatric neurosurgeon who's stamping out malignant brain tumors in children. And we will hear from Christina Alvira, who is a pediatrician, innovating ways to guarantee healthy lung development in children. The order of the speakers will be Theo, Christina, and then Sam. Again, they're all doing incredible stuff. And I guess as they round out, I'll come back up and explain what happens after this, which will be a fantastic wine and heavy bites event down in the Nest where we'll hear from a bunch of different companies. But without further ado, I'd like to introduce Theo Palmer. Again, focusing on neurodevelopment.
Thank you very much. So, and now for something completely different. We'll talk to you a little bit about mice and whether or not mice can actually get autism. And I think at the end of the 15 minutes, you might believe me that yes, mice can have autism. But first, this is a short story that's authored by four and more very talented people in the lab. Four fellows, Pam Carpenter, Ursula Hedich, Amy Moon, and Harion Lee. And everything you see in this talk has been generated by them or the students and technicians working with them. And so I really owe it to some people that are smarter than me in my lab who have been doing some very interesting work. So without further ado, this is a talk about autism. And this graph comes from Autism Speaks Foundation. It should scare the bejesus out of you. If you think about autism prevalence and how much it has been increasing and, you know, doubling in the last 15 years, humans don't evolve that quickly. We don't have genetic mutations that accumulate that at that rate. So something is happening. Part of this is due to changes in diagnostic criterion, more awareness of autism. Parents are insisting that their children have a diagnosis of some kind, but that may only account for about a quarter of the increase in diagnoses. So something's going on. Now, recently, last year in fact, there were two studies, one in general population study and one a twin study, showing that beyond a shadow of a doubt, genetics plays a very important role in autism. About half of all cases of autism can be accounted for by perhaps 500 genes, 600 genes, each one providing a very small effect. However, that leaves the other half completely unaccounted for from genetics. And so essentially, half of all cases of autism are caused by other factors. Well, what can these other factors be? So there are a number of very interesting associations. If you are a slightly older parent, if you have a higher degree than most people, and if you're a professional and make a little bit more money, you might have 1.5 times the chance of having a child with autism as somebody who doesn't fit in that socioeconomic category. Agricultural pesticides are a new and perhaps interesting thing, especially for our Central Valley in California. Adverse events during pregnancy are very penetrant. Non-genetic events that might influence outcome. These include uterine bleeding, so if you have a little placental abruption during pregnancy, that can be a factor. Perinatal hypoxia, so if the baby needs oxygen at birth, that's a very strong indicator that there is a higher risk for the baby. Congenital infections, rubella and CMV that actually invade the amniotic cavity and infect the baby, those are extremely hazardous conditions, risky conditions. But even simpler things like simple immune events in first and second trimester are associated with an increase. So is this cause or just simply coincidence. It's really hard to tell without actually understanding that there is a mechanism that can be demonstrated, and that's where the animal models come in. So we're very interested in just mild immune events that happen in pregnancy, and so it's not just autism. Things like asthma and allergies in the mom during first and second trimester can be associated with a twofold increase. So that'd be one in every 30 instead of one in every 60 kids. Schizophrenia. If you have influenza in first trimester, mom does, that's a sevenfold increase in diagnoses in the kids. Very well documented in years of pandemic, in influenza pandemics. But these are showing you that it's not necessarily an infection of the fetus or a problem with the developing child itself, but more immune signaling. So how do you really study that? And the model that we use in the lab is a model involving a mouse. And so a mom gets an injection of a compound that activates an immune response. The pregnancy then continues. We do pregnancy outcome measures just like you would in the clinic. And then we ask whether these animals function differently. And how sick do these animals really get? We use a compound that's derived from bacteria. It models a bacterial infection. It's called lipopolysaccharide, or LPS. LPS, when injected into humans or mice, gives the same phenotypes. So you have reduced activity. So anybody who's been sick has experienced every one of these features. Poor grooming, that's definitely true for me. Low growth, a low-grade fever, reduced food and water intake, and of course weight loss because you're not eating and drinking as much. So how sick do they really get? You can change the dose that you give to a pregnant mouse to the point where if high enough, it's life-threatening to the mouse, to the mom. If you reduce that, then you can begin mimicking a three-day flu or a three-day illness of some kind. However, in mice, the pregnancy is so sensitive to this type of challenge that none of the pups survive. So you have to reduce it even more, down to a fifth of that. And now maybe 25% of the pups are surviving. But the behavior, the evidence of illness or sickness in the animal is beginning to go away. Finally, you get down to levels of 50 or 25 micrograms. That's a millionth of a gram for every 2 pounds of animal. That's a pretty low dose. And at the bottom end of the spectrum, you can see now we're having all of the pups survive. And we've been using a dose now that is at that threshold level where almost all the pups survive, but it's challenging enough that we can actually measure a complication in pregnancy. So what happens in these animals? Well, we can measure behaviors that are related to autism, like changes in socialization. And in this particular field up here, we have a mouse. It's put in a chamber, and it gets to choose to explore this area where there's a mouse hiding under a pencil cup, or the pencil cup itself, which is an unfamiliar object. And we heard earlier from Craig, they love novelty, and so they'll explore both. But they like mice better than cups. And so they'll spend a little bit more time in the area with the mouse. And you can see that normally there's higher than 50% of the time they're exploring the mouse. But if they have been exposed to a challenge during gestation, then their interest in the other mouse is reduced. So they have lower social interest. Repetitive compulsive behaviors in a mouse can be measured. They don't like marbles or foreign things in their cage, and so they'll try to bury them. A normal mouse will bury a couple of them in a given amount of time, but a mouse that comes from one of the challenged pregnancies will bury many more. And in fact, it becomes quite obsessive for those mice to get rid of those marbles. And then you can also measure more complex cognitive behaviors, learning and memory. And so this is a paradigm that we call the water maze. Basically, it's just a horse watering trough. And it has opaque, we use children's finger paint to make the water opaque. And under the dotted line there, there's a little platform just under the water, and the mouse swims around until it finds that and it can get out, and then it gets rescued from the water. And so we give them a bunch of learning trials. The mouse swims around randomly in the first session trying to find the trial. We give it a few more trials, and it now knows to look over on this side because it's on that side of the room. It's not on the side where the investigator was. And then finally, at the end of the day, the mouse knows that it's right there and swims directly to that platform. So they learn this task really well. Just if they've had a gestational immune event, they learn it less well. And so it takes them a little bit longer to learn that task. And they never actually get quite as good as their normal litter mates. So we now know that this is caused by several mechanisms. It includes the mom. It includes changes in placental function. It includes changes in the way the brain develops in the fetus. So I'm just going to show you a couple of examples of what's happening in these mice. This is a set of mouse placentas. This illness actually causes the placentas to bleed a little bit. And the more the bleeding, the more endangered the pup becomes. And in fact, if you have enough damage, you lose the pregnancy entirely. So the bleeding is accompanied by changes in fetal heart rate. So anybody who's had a child has undergone ultrasound, and you can see the baby's heart beating. We do this for the mice, and you can tell that with the challenge and the damage, you have a reduction in the heart rate and a reduction in blood flow to the fetus. That reduction in blood flow then actually causes hypoxia. So this is the same kind of condition that would require a newborn baby to have oxygen administered. And here, in this case, the red marker is tissue that has undergone extreme hypoxia. And you can see there's more red in animals that have had the challenge than in the animals that are the controls. So all of this combines to change both development in the fetal brain. So at early embryonic times in the fetal brain, you can track the stem cell behavior. And that change in stem cell behavior then translates out to changes in the anatomy and function of the mouse. So every mom gets sick, right? Everyone during pregnancy gets ill. Why aren't all kids autistic? So there has to be something more. So what we are thinking in the lab is that genes that confer risk of autism might synergize with immune events or other environmental factors, might synergize with increased wealth and education. We're not really sure. But in this particular case, we're interested in genes that might play a role in the brain, but also play a role in immune signaling or vulnerability to immune signaling. And one gene I'm going to talk to you about today is a gene that is involved both in regulating neural network activity in the brain, but also regulates immune function. And it's the GABA-A receptor subunit beta 3. So the GABA-A receptor is a pentamer. It has five subunits. Single gene mutations or whole chromosomal mutations are implicated in several neurodevelopmental disorders. And so it's widely thought to be important in brain development and brain function. And the question was, does loss of a single GABA beta 3 allele change risk in the mouse model? And so, in fact, there is a monstrous synergy between these environmental, the immune challenge, and the gene. So here we're measuring the amount of pathology that is caused by the immune challenge in the placenta. With a small dose or a slightly bigger dose, you can see that normally a wild-type animal, a control animal, will have an X amount of pathology. There's an increase if you have the gene and the immune challenge together. In fact, in this particular experiment, none of the pups survived because the vulnerability of the placenta became so much greater than it would have been in a control condition. So the effect of the mutation alone, the effect of the challenge alone, and then the effect of the combined. So there is a combinatorial effect on placental vulnerability. Also, social interactions. The effect of the mutation alone, no effect. So this particular mutation doesn't influence social interaction all by itself in the mouse. However, if you, and LPS or the immune challenge has a mild effect with higher doses, but you have a very significant effect. Essentially, the mouse no longer prefers the mouse over the inanimate object. And this happens at much lower doses than you would have expected. Learning and marble burying, effect of the mutation alone, the effect of the immune challenge alone, and the effect of the combination. Quite synergistic. And in one particular type of learning and memory, also a water maze task, but different than the one I showed you before, the gene mutation or the challenge alone has no measurable effect. The animals perform beautifully. However, they cannot actually learn this task if they have the combinatorial challenge. So 50% genetics, 50% environment. If other genes and environmental factors synergize the same way, I think that we can very clearly say that we have cause and not just coincidence. And so to summarize, I think there's an immune event that we're eliciting in the mouse, but it's also phenocopying two of the other pregnancy complications that are alone associated with risk, which is uterine bleeding and perinatal hypoxia. So in just one event, you can have several of the complicating or risk factors reproduced. Now, if mice are little humans, you could imagine that with a diagnostic that involved identifying a genetic risk and an understanding of how that genetic risk interacts with an environmental factor and whether those synergize, you could begin identifying pregnancies that are at very high risk. So I think gestational illness does change brain development. There are behavioral consequences to those. Genetic predisposition, gene-environment interactions could be pretty significant, but just illness alone, moms in the crowd or planning to be moms in the crowd, is just a source of cognitive diversity. So thank you.